back to your old ways, it's there and it's very strong. So you have to learn to control yourself and not say things that you really want to say.
Right.
Even though you're not going to say it in a mean way, but it's going to be confrontational. You try to avoid those things. And, you know, I think I mentioned this before, but in situations like that, I keep going back to where it says in the Word that, you know, with his mouth shut, even a fool is considered wise.
Yeah.
So I want to be, or at least appear to be wise, which is why I try not to say anything. But as I went through this situation and I was thinking about this, I started now looking at this from what is this person doing, but more of how can I lead by example? You know, what can I do so that this person can see Christ through me? And as I was looking for some scriptures, I was led to these. And in Colossians chapter 3, verse 16, it says, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God." So I have to let the word of Christ dwell in me richly. I have to let it teach me, you know, and I have to allow it to give me wisdom. But I also have to praise, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. But I also have to be thankful in my heart, and I have to be thankful to God. Those things I have to allow to take place in me for whatever work God is doing in me to be manifested. So this is what I'm trying to do on how I'm dealing with this person. Titus chapter 2, verses 6 through 8, it says, "Likewise, urge the younger men to be self-controlled." I have to be self-controlled, which is why I decided to keep my mouth shut. "Show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works, and in your teaching, show integrity, dignity, and sound speech that cannot be condemned, so that an opponent may be put to shame, having nothing evil to say about us." So I have to be respectful. I have to be a model of good works. I have to let my actions speak for myself rather than my mouth. How do I do that? Acting like Christ. I have to be humble. I have to be meek. I have to have two ears to listen and one mouth to speak. I have to make sure that I say things that are actually edifying, rather than whatever thought comes to my mind. Because if I allow that to happen, I am letting my flesh take over my spirit. And I don't want to do that. But I also have to, and with my actions, you know, I have to show integrity and dignity. That way, anything that is said against me, people around me that are hearing those things, and I'm not talking about things that are being said specifically about me, I'm talking about in general, because this person wasn't saying anything, but with my actions, whatever is said about us, everybody around us that see our actions and hear these things that are being said are going to know that they're lies.
Amen.
Which is why nothing evil can be said about us. In Philippians chapter 4, verses 8 and 9, it says, says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. The things that Paul heard, the things that he taught to the people that listened to him, the things that he gave them, the things that he spoke to them, we have also seen, heard, read those things, because everything that he was taught is something that God spoke. Mm-hmm. The revelation he had from who Jesus Christ was.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the same revelation that we receive,
right,
when we allow the Holy Spirit to speak,
that's right,
to ourselves.
Right.
And those are the things that we need to practice. When we do, the God of peace is going to be with us.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Those are the things that I continue to remind myself as I have the struggle between my spirit and my flesh when situations like this happen. As I practice these things, I know that God is there with me. He's with me all the time. There's some situations or circumstances in which when we open our spirit to him, it's easier for us to recognize that he's there, even
mm-hmm.
though we already know.
Mm-hmm.
And the last scripture, Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility, count others more significant than yourself. This is something that is really hard to do, because in our human nature, we are selfish and we put ourselves first. Let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also to the interest of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, and by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. He died for us. Our old selves died on that cross when he was nailed, and he died. The more we remind ourselves of this, the more we allow his spirit to move inside of us, so that we can be humble and put others' interests before us and be selfless. When we renew our minds to what can I do to fix this wrongdoing that was done to me, when we change from that to let me understand the situation to see how can I help this person, those are the things that we need to do. And that's what I have to continue to remind myself, that it's what I need to do in order to be able to deal with this situation the way God wants me to deal with this situation. What's going to come out of this? I don't know. He knows. I don't know if through me this person is going to receive some sort of revelation that it's going to change the way they behave towards certain things. I would really like that, because that would be a great testimony if it were to happen. But I'm just going to let him work what he wants to work. And I pray that he continues to use me, and that he continues to give me wisdom so that I can be an example to others that know him but are to be meek and that I keep my mouth shut when situations like this happen, because I don't want to get myself in trouble. So I'm just going to let him continue to work in me and stand strong in that word, and we'll wait for manifestation to happen.
Amen.
So
amen.
That's my word tonight. Any prayer requests or testimonies? So.
I just want to say that that reminds me, I have a pillow that I made that says on that pillow that live in such a way that if somebody is around you, I can't remember now without having the pillow in front of me, that if they don't know God, they'll come to knowing because of you, which is exactly what you're saying.
Yeah.
You're representing Christ in the earth, and the only way that person may have the opportunity to know the Lord is through you.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's good.
Mark.
Yeah, I was driving yesterday, so I got up late, and so I was thinking to myself, you know, I had a couple things I wanted to do, and I was just feeling like this very, really anxious spirit. And kind of, confused or whatever. And so I said, Lord, I just give it to you. Let me just go. And I got in my vehicle, and I just started driving around, and just real slow. And I just started feeling like the Holy Spirit coming on me, and I just said, God, can I get any closer to you? I feel your presence of the Holy Spirit, but how close can I get to you by being obedient? What do you want me to see? And as I was driving, I saw this, on 56th Street in Des Moines, I saw this grandfather with his daughter mowing the yard. And she was sitting up front, and he was letting her drive and stuff. And I just took it in, you know.
Yeah.
And I said, well, thank you, Lord. I was on my way to Walmart. I got to Walmart, and I just pulled in. I wasn't anxious anymore. I just sat there, and I said, Lord, what do you want me to see? And I started just looking around, and I started thinking about, you know, my pain and my knee and everything. And then all of a sudden, this fairly young woman got out of this car, and she had a prosthetic leg. And I didn't even know it. I mean, she got out. I mean, you could see it. She had shorts on. And she got out, and she was just walking like I am. And I started thinking about what she must have had to go through to get where she is. But she was just getting around in the car like regular legs. You know, and I'm thinking, that just didn't happen overnight. She must have been, she went through a lot of pain emotionally, whatever. And I stopped and I thought, thank you, Lord. Thank you that I have who I, you have made me who I am today. That I have all my limbs. And then I started thinking more, and I said, he reminded me, look what I've done with your life in the past 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
Look at where you're living, look at the vehicle you're driving, look at the things I've allowed you to do, because you've been obedient with your finances. And, you know, he says, it's not over. It's nowhere near over. And you can start to give that.
There you go.
Take care of your body. Because it's my temple.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if you can see this woman, I mean, you can do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I'm thinking, you know, I haven't got anything to complain about. I haven't got anything to feel bad about. When I see things like that, and I see the grandpa, there was a granddaughter mowing the yard, I think of my dad before he passed and stuff, giving my son a ride on the tractor. And it's just like, you know, all these things just came back reminding me of what God's done in my life.
Amen.
Yeah, that's good.
So,
that's good.
I just pray.
Thank you. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
big smile. Said, this is the life I want. I want to do this for my family, my boys, my future.
Mm-hmm.
And then in a few weeks, you know, he's gone.
Yeah.
And I guess God just let me know that, you know what, Tim? You know, everybody's given so many days, you know, and when it's time God calls you home.
Yep.
And so it may be 40 years, maybe 50 years, maybe 60 years, maybe 20 years. But when you love God through all that time, you know, realize that we all got reputations, you know. And the best reputation you have is you are a representative of Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
We're called ambassadors.
Yeah.
So I just ask you to just pray for his family. His first name is Jay. And just pray for his sons and his family.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Keep Cindy lifted up. She was doing, getting gradually better the last 2-3 days. I appreciate your prayers. Today she had a little setback. I think she said she overdid it, but praying for complete healing and recovery so she can get back and join us in fellowship and get back on her feet and do the things she wants to do. So,
amen.
Pray
amen.
For the Lord and believe in it.
Yes. Amen.
If we could also pray for my manager, his name is Mike. A few weeks ago, he got blindsided by divorce papers. Apparently, his wife had been planning it for the past 6 months, and he had no idea that was going on. I would like it if I can serve as an example to him of what to do when that happens, since I went through that recently, and he can see how God turned my life around.
Mm-hmm.
And
yes.
How I am now compared to where I was 3 years ago when this happened. And either there's restoration in there, because they have two boys. I think they're 7 and 3. Or if it's not for them to be together, that at least he finds the peace that he needs to continue moving forward and believing that not only that God loves him, but also if he has someone else for him, he's going to come to find that person and find love again.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Anyone else? Okay, well, let's stand. And let's come to the altar tonight with cast all our cares upon our Father. We thank you tonight for bringing us together here to be gathered in your name. We thank you, Lord, because you give us your word, a word that works within us. And your Holy Spirit manifests and reveals to us the truth that you want us to know and understand. We thank you, Father, for all the gifts that you give us, for giving us patience, for giving us meekness, wisdom, Lord, for giving us being humble, Father, for being able to speak your word to others and give them an encouragement, and for being your representatives here on this earth. Father, we pray for all of those that are suffering, that are brokenhearted, that you restore their hearts, Lord. Comfort them in this time of need. Now that they are suffering, Jesus. unite your bodies again. May your people may rejoice in you. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction of this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord renews the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of the servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. John, would you be so kind, please?
Heavenly Father, we just praise you tonight, God, for another time to be with your saints, with your house, God. Just bless this service, Lord, for your glory that we desire to lift you up and see you move. And in this offering, God, as we give unto you,
yes,
just bless the people. And God, help us in walking with you and trusting you more. And through it all, God, no matter what, there's a lot of stuff that comes and question, and you're the answer to it all anyway. So we just praise you and just lift up thy holy name and give thanks. And just praise thy holy name, in Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Starting next Monday. Hallelujah.
Smallest thing that lives. I can't contain this love inside, but after all, why should I? I have to let the world hear what it is. All of creation is waiting. part to play, what joy I make, enthusiastic sound. I'm so excited for the time when everything will have one mind. Oh, let it all explode from us right now. All of creation is waiting for you in me, and you love everything that you made. And I'm gonna join with heaven and earth to sing together.
Thank you. lead us, to guide us into all truth. We bless you tonight, Lord, for your goodness. Thank you, Jesus, for your great love. And we bless your name. And everybody said, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. God bless you. You may be
seated.
Hallelujah.
Thank the Lord. Praise God. I was looking at some of the scriptures when Roberto was opening the service. By the way, thank you, Roberto, for last Wednesday. And Suzanne, although she's not here, I appreciate her standing in for me Sunday. And praise the Lord, you didn't want what I had. Hallelujah. And when Roberto was speaking about in Colossians, where it talks about the peace of God ruling your hearts, to the which also you're called in one body, be thankful, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns, spiritual songs, singing, and this is the part I like, with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And he was talking about the situation with the co-worker. And it made me think about what sometimes we don't realize what it is we are doing is actually releasing grace.
Yes, we are.
We're doing the one thing that we can do to be like God.
Yes.
And when he was reading from in Titus, talking about sound speech that cannot be condemned, that he that is of the contrary part may be ashamed, having no evil thing to say of you. And it goes on to talk about exhort servants to be obedient and so on and so forth, not purloining. And then in verse 11, two verses later, it says, adorn the doctrine of God, our Savior, in all things. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. Praise the Lord. So I want to talk to you about that tonight. And we'll begin with Galatians chapter 3 and verse 21. There's a scripture that talks, I cannot remember if I don't remember the exact verse, chapter, the scripture. I remember the scripture, but I can't tell you where it is, so just bear with me. But anyway, it says that patience is developed by a need for patience, right? I mean, everybody pray for patience. You know you're going to be in a situation where it's going to demand to be patient. But it says faith is perfected through patience. So a lot of times we pray. Now, I definitely believe in instantaneous healings and deliverance and breakthroughs in every area, but sometimes there's a process. Sometimes it demands patience. To continue to believe God, to trust God, to declare His goodness and His grace and His mercy, even when it doesn't look like you're being a recipient of it at the moment.
Right.
And so sometimes we have to realize that it's grace that even allows us to be patient, to not just throw up our hands and give up and blame God and get angry and do all those sorts of things. So we'll get to that in a minute. But is the law then against the promises of God? God forbid. For if there had been a law given which could have given life, verily righteousness should have been by the law. Right? So that tells you right there, nobody becomes righteous or in right standing with God through obedience to the law. That doesn't mean we shouldn't be moral people. That doesn't mean we shouldn't try to do the right things. It's just that you can't do it through your own strength, through your own ability. You can't do it. If you could, there would have been no need for a better covenant.
Right.
Under the covenant of the law would have been sufficient, but he's telling us that life can't come that way. So, verily, righteousness should have been by the law if that were the case. Okay? Now, let's go to Matthew chapter 5 and verse, I was going to say 48, but let's read 47 and 48, just because it puts 48 in a little better context, I think. If you salute your brethren only, now this goes back, if you go back a little bit further, it'll talk about if you, excuse me, if you just treat people nice that treat you nice, what's the big deal?
Right.
He says even the Pharisees or the scribes and so forth, they do that. And then he goes on, that's what he's talking about here. If you're just good to people that are good to you, if you're just nice to people that are nice to you, like in the situation that Roberta was talking about, if you retaliate because they're a jerk, you're no different than everybody else, right? So it's being good to people that don't deserve to be good to, right?
Exactly.
If you therefore salute therefore your brethren only, what do you more than others? Do not even the publicans do that? In other words, greet them and be kind to them and so on and so forth, right? But here's the catch. Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. Now, in my Bible, let me just go back here because it may not be in everybody's notes, but if you go back to here in Matthew chapter 5, I believe it is, right? Matthew 5, verse 48. Mine has a note just above it. Where be therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. And the footnote is, act graciously towards others. That's how we are like God. God treats people with grace. They don't deserve grace. None of us deserved it. But even the sinners, God is still gracious to them. If he wasn't, they'd be gone. Now, they've got to come to Christ at some point. They've got to trust in the Lord for their salvation. But even today, God isn't punishing them. They're reaping what they sow. They're getting the results of sowing to the wind and behaviors and so on and so forth. But it isn't God punishing them. God is being, this is the dispensation of grace. This is how he's dealing with this whole world, is by grace. Amen? So the way we can be like God is exactly what we heard here tonight. Amen? Because There's a wild and unruly aspect of identifying with Christ, because we have to give up our checklist of the law in order, grace to be able to work. We have to follow somebody that we can't see. We got to follow somebody that a lot of times we can't feel. And all the time having trouble wrapping our minds around him and his greatness and his goodness and his power and his glory and his, you know, omnipotence. So I'm going to just let you in on a little secret tonight. There is a huge disclaimer to the Christian life, a disclaimer that most people have missed, or at least ignored, that the Christian life really is impossible. In our own abilities, in our own strength. It's impossible. Those nagging thoughts and the questions, we have of our own ability, those thoughts are true. Amen. It isn't just the devil coming and telling you can't do this. Your own mind's telling you, this is beyond me. We're not competent for the task. I've got sticky notes all over my side of the bathroom mirror. I put them there all the time. You know, my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches. They're scriptures, you know. I mean, I just put them up there because they're a reminder and it keeps it fresh in my mind. And first thing in the morning, you know, that's what I see. And so they're good. Sticky notes are good. But the problem is, they're not enough. They won't make you adequate to live the Christian life. Praise the Lord. The things God asks of us as followers of Christ are attitudes and actions that involve the heart. That's why we are born again from the inside out. It's a heart thing. It's a spirit thing. Amen. He said, I'll write my laws in their heart. He wasn't talking about writing the Ten Commandments in their heart, but the laws of love, the law of faith, the New Testament law. Amen? But it's in our heart, right? And so it's attitudes and things that we can't really change physically by our own ability. It's something that we can't reach by our own effort. or our want to. Praise the Lord. But here's another secret. Maybe not as much a secret as a misapplied or underapplied truth. God gives us what we need to live the Christian life. And He gives it in the form of Himself. And what we heard here tonight already in the testimonies, that's the Holy Spirit working in us. And our flesh, as Roberto was saying, and all of us know innately, I guess, our flesh is at war with the Spirit. It wants to retaliate. It wants eye for eye, tooth for tooth. It wants, when somebody does me wrong, I want to do them wrong. I want to get even. I want to get back. I want to repay. Amen? But we have this treasure in an earthen vessel. So even though we're inadequate to do what it is we know we ought to do and would like to do, God gives something, His Spirit, to make it possible.
Amen.
So that we can do it.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. John 16 and verse 7. And that's why it's so important that, like Myron was saying, we listen to the Holy Spirit. We ask the Holy Spirit to lead us. Not that He isn't leading us anyway, but how many of you know you can be led and not even know you're being led? And you know, God can get us into situations that sometimes we don't even realize how we got there or why we're there. But if we're aware, if we're conscious, if we're interacting with God, if we're talking with God, then when that bad leg of mine is bothering me and I see somebody with no leg, immediately I hear the Holy Spirit saying, you know, things could be a lot worse. Thank God you've got both your legs, even if one of them's hurting right now.
Yeah.
Amen? And so those kinds of things are going on all the time. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send Him unto you. Amen? So if we're going to live by faith and in grace instead of our own goodness, we cannot afford to ignore the Holy Ghost. We can't afford to be oblivious to what God is trying to do in us and through us. We have to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. That's the job we have. The job is of faith, that believe that God's going to supply a way in which He can be manifest, in a way that He can be seen in whatever the situation is that we're dealing with. Amen? And He does that by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Praise the Lord. Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God, who also hath made us able ministers. Oh, look at that. So we don't have the ability, but yet He has made us able. Able to minister, amen, the New Testament, not of the letter. What's the New Testament? It's the grace of God, amen, of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. Because the letter killeth, but the Spirit gives life.
Yes.
Amen. If you go by the letter, you know, it's eye for eye. It's tooth for tooth.
Yes.
It's get them before they get you. And get the good ones twice, you know. Praise the Lord. So, amen. All right, Galatians chapter 3 and verse 3. Are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit? Are you now made perfect by the flesh? All right, drop down to verse 5. He therefore that ministereth to you the Spirit and worketh miracles among you, doeth he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? See, the Spirit, it justifies and it sanctifies. Now, we are justified and we are sanctified, but our actions can be justified and sanctified by the Spirit if we're sensitive. Because we know, even though we're justified and even though we're sanctified, we don't always act justified, nor do we always act sanctified. So we need to be in tune with the Holy Spirit in order for that to be manifest, and that's how God is revealed. That's how God gets revealed. By grace. Amen. He is the Spirit of grace. Praise God. Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 and 17. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, which is what I just spoke about a moment ago. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. If you don't stay in tune with the Spirit, you're going to be contrary to God. You're going to be working against the Spirit of God and against what God's trying to do. Amen? So quit pretending that we can be good Christians according to how we behave or how we look or how we talk or how we make decisions. We can only be Christians by the Spirit of God, by being led by the Holy Ghost. Praise God. Our external behaviors often look really good on paper. But good Christian behavior doesn't do anybody any good, because good Christian behavior doesn't create joy in my heart. It may give me a little smug satisfaction, but it doesn't create joy. It doesn't bring joy. It doesn't bring peace. Amen? It doesn't do anything to create that. It doesn't do anything to help me to know God's love. Amen? Nor does it enable me to fight off the lust of the flesh. Right. Only the Holy Spirit can do that. Only God can do that. Give up on the idea that a list of behavior is the way to abundant life. It's not. It's the way to frustration, aggravation, and bitterness. Stop fighting against what we all know from experience to be true. We can't live this Christian life. We need help. Amen. We need the Holy Spirit. We need God alive and active and moving in our lives. So let's, how about we do what Paul did? We fall into our weakness, not in the sense of giving up or self-punishment, but recognize we live only by the power of God and not by our strength, not by our abilities, not by our goodness. But because of His grace and His goodness. 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 4. This, if we think this way, I'm saying this because this makes it more likely that we will then extend grace to others. If we're aware of our weakness, we're more sensitive to the weaknesses of others. If we realize it's God that's helping me, then it's going to take God to help them. I can't blame them that they're all screwed up. I need to get God to them. I need to get them in touch with God, because it's the only thing that's going to change. It's the only thing that's going to help them. That's why we have to be willing to share grace, because that is a true representation of God. Amen. That's a real revelation of God's personality, character, and reality, for that matter. For though He was crucified through weakness, yet He liveth by the power of God. For we also are weak in Him, but we shall live with Him by the power of God toward you. Praise the Lord. That's good. That's good news. Amen. So how do we do? How do we live by the power of the Holy Spirit? Well, we fight for joy. We struggle for peace. But we don't cast our cares on the Lord. We do it by faith. We do it believing that He cares for me. So I can cast my care upon Him, because He careth for me. I don't need to struggle with it. I don't need to fight with it. I don't need to try to overcome it. I need to just give it to Him and trust that He can deal with it. Whatever it is, to live by the power of God, fully alive in Him and His grace to us, we've got to receive the help that God offers. It can't happen otherwise. Whatever is not of faith is sin. Whatever is not of faith is unbelief. It's believing that God isn't what God says He is. It's believing that God won't do what God says He'll do. It's sin because if we believe that our efforts are the way to produce heart and character transformation, we're saying we're God. He's the only one that can do it. We can control our life and our circumstances. We're saying we have power to do what only God can do. That's why controlling our fears through effort is so dangerous. Let's cast them to the Lord. Fear not, fear not, fear not, over and over and over. I think someone did a study on that, 365 fear nots, one for every day. And most of us need it every day. Because stuff happens that's frightening, that creates anxiety, that creates stress, that creates worry, and so forth. Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6. One of my favorite scriptures. Being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Praise God. The Christian life is received from start to finish.
Yes.
It isn't done by us. It's something we receive from God. Well, so what's left to say? God has taken responsibility for everything in our past, present, and future. Salvation, past and future, he's taken responsibility for it. It's of grace, not of works, lest somebody should boast. It's a gift of God. A source for helping us to live for God and with God in the moment, present, and future. A complete removal of condemnation and guilt and shame, past, present, future. And a hope that's greater than any present circumstance or any future circumstance. That God is for me. That God is on my side.
Yes.
That God is with me.
Yes.
To give
yes.
me victory.
Yes.
It's summed up like this. God is for us.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. And because he is, who can stand against us? No one. Nothing can come in and remove God's grace or God's favor for us.
Exactly.
Because God's way has nothing to do with what we can or can't do, or what we do or don't do. And because it has everything to do with Christ, with what Christ has done and what the Spirit continues to do in us.
Exactly.
Praise God. We can never be separated from his great love. He gives more than enough so that we are more than conquerors. We just receive what he freely offers and we rejoice. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Praise the Lord. It's not my strength that brings joy. It's the joy of the Lord that brings strength. Praise God. Amen. Sometimes we get it backwards. But God's got it all figured out. If we'll trust him, he will lead us and guide us into all truth. He'll lead us and guide us into the truth that is needed for every circumstance and every situation that we're confronted with. If we'll do like I've heard many times, too many times, you know, the Spirit leads us, but we're out trying to lead the Spirit. We're getting in front and out in front of him and not sure what to do and just do something and then hope he'll come along and bless it afterwards. We need to be led. So that the Spirit can do what only the Spirit can do through us. See, God is a spirit. So is Satan. And both of them need a body to operate in this earth. He has a body, the church. But unless the church is sensitive and submitted to him, it's like having a paralytic body. It's just there, but it can't do anything. Praise God. God is only limited to the degree that we believe. If thou canst believe, all things are possible. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Give the Lord a hand clap tonight. Praise God. Amen, amen. God bless you. I appreciate y'all preaching my message for me tonight, so I didn't really have to work too hard. Amen. You had it way ahead of me. That's the nice thing about the Holy Ghost, right?
Amen.
We all got the same spirit. Amen. He has a tendency to talk to all of us through one another. So God is good. Amen. And he is on the throne. Praise God. God bless all of you. I appreciate you being here tonight. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Hope we'll see you here Sunday.